Hello everyone, let's review the digestive system. We all know that nutrition is one of the characteristics of life, therefore all living organisms should take food. And humans are heterotrophic organisms. It means that they take food from other organisms, and these heterotroph organisms should digest this food. There are two types of digestion. The one is intracellular digestion. It's with the help of the lysosome inside the cell, and the polymer should be taken to the cell, and this polymer particles, food particles, should be digested inside the cell, and these food particles generally taken with endocytosis. This endocytosis can be phagocytosis or pinocytosis, and after taking these particles, lysosome digest these polymers into monomers inside the cell. This is intracellular digestion, and many cells can make intracellular digestion, such as amoeba or hydra or white blood cells of human can make intracellular digestion. But we are going to especially emphasize on the extracellular digestion in this unit, because this extracellular digestion occurs inside the body but outside of the cell. The food particles break down into monomers inside the digestive tract. Digestive tract, for example, the lumen of intestine is outside of the cell. For example, mouth is inside the body but outside of the cell. And this digestion is called extracellular digestion. Both food particles are mixed with the digestive enzyme. Outside of the cell, it's called extracellular digestion. Also, we can divide the digestion into two other types. This is mechanical digestion and chemical digestion. Mechanical or physical digestion is just the breakdown of food into physical by small fragments. And mechanical digestion, for example, chewing of the mouth with the help of teeth or the crunching of stomach is the example of mechanical digestion. In mechanical digestion, enzymes are not used. And the digested molecule is not monomer. Therefore, they cannot pass through the cell membrane. But in chemical digestion, the food is broken down with the help of digestive enzyme. And these enzymes also we can call these enzyme hydrolytic enzyme, and these enzyme digest the polymer into monomer, and this monomer can pass through the cell membrane at the end of chemical digestion. Okay, let me continue with these main stages of food processing. In the human and in, for example, in this cat, there are 5 steps of food processing. The first step is the taking food. Taking food is called ingestion, eating. It's very simply eating. After taking food, the food should be digested into monomers or small monomers to absorb. And this digestion includes both mechanical and chemical digestion, but especially the chemical digestion. After that, the digested monomers should be absorbed. Absorption is the third step, and these monomers, nutrients, should be taken by the first blood vessels and lymph vessels, and therefore by the other cells, or for example, in the digestive tract, in the in the layer of the mucosa, the intestine, the cell absorb from the lumen, small intestine lumen, to the cells. Assimilation is another step. In the assimilation, these nutrients, these monomers, goes to the cells, and cells make new polymers for itself. For example, amino acid is absorbed. Then this amino acid goes to the other cell, for example, goes to the brain cell or liver cell, and this amino acid is used for the protein production. This making new synthesis in the cell with the help of these monomer is called assimilation. After that, the undigested material, the unused or removal of undigested material is eliminated. This elimination or adjustion is the last step of food processing. Okay. Let's look at the organs of the digestive tract. The organ of the digestive tract, there is a digestive cavity, digestive tract, and some accessory organs. This white part is the digestive tract. For example, look at in this simple picture. It starts from the mouth, then esophagus, stomach, small intestine, large intestine, rectum, and anus. This is the digestive tract. And there are some organs such as salivary glands, liver and gallbladder, and pancreas. These are accessory organs. They send their secretion to the digestive tract, but food goes from this digestive tract, and the undigested material is eliminated through to anus, via the anus to the outside of the body. Okay, let's look at this picture. In the mouth, there is a tongue and there is a teeth also. Salivary glands secrete the saliva to the mouth, and it's the opening is called the oral cavity. After the mouth, the organ is the pharynx, which sent the food particle to the esophagus. After that, there is a esophagus, this tube, it's called esophagus. After that, the stomach is the organ for the foods, goes to the stomach. After that, small intestine, this one, then large intestine, and rectum and anus. This is the way of the digestive tract. But also, there is a gallbladder here. It's store bile inside it. There is a liver, and also it's the accessory organs, and there is a pancreas under the stomach, and it also secretes digestive enzyme and bicarbonate ions to the digestive tract. Okay, let's look at their structure one by one. Mouth have tongue, and it digestive begins here, both mechanical and chemical digestion. In the oral cavity, mechanical digestion occurs with the help of grinding of the teeth, and with the help of amylase enzyme inside the salivary gland secretes saliva. It lubricates food also. It have the enzyme amylase, and amylase start the chemical digestion of carbohydrates. Also, there is another enzyme in the saliva. It's called lysozyme, and lysozyme enzyme is digest the microorganism and make disinfect the inside the oral cavity. Mm-hmm. And the shape of the food is called bolus, which is goes to the pharynx and esophagus after swallowing. And these are the type of the teeth, canine, molar and premolar and incisors, according to their function. These are the type of the teeth. After the mouth, there's pharynx. Pharynx is the region we called our thorax pharynx, and it's the junction between esophagus and trachea. Also, the eustachian tube is opens to the pharynx also, and it decide it close them with the help of epiglottis. There is an epiglottis here. This one is the epiglottis. And this epiglottis up and down, and it prevents the food particles entering to the trachea, to the windpipe. And esophagus, it contains mostly the smooth muscle, but at the upper part of the esophagus have the skeletal muscle, and the lower part of the esophagus have the smooth muscle. So this swallowing start as a reflex, but it's start with voluntary, but goes as a reflex with the peristaltic movement. Peristalsis is the movement of food particles all through the digestive tract, but also it's seen in the esophagus by the contraction of these smooth muscles. There is no digestion, no chemical digestion occurs in the pharynx and in the esophagus. There is no secretion sent, any enzyme sent to the pharynx or esophagus. But after that, these food particles comes to the stomach, Stomach again is the site for both chemical and physical digestion. There are different type of cell, parietal cell and chef cell located in the mucosa layer of stomach. And stomach is the organ located on the left upper side of the abdominal cavity. And this organ have three layers of smooth muscle, this longitudinal muscle, circular muscle, and obligate muscle. And with the help of these muscle contraction, mechanical digestion occur inside the cell. The mucosa layer secrete gastric juice, and gastric juice contains mucus, hydrochloric acid, pepsinogen, the enzyme for the protein synthesis. Also renin, this is another enzyme for the milk digestion, and also water. It contains, the gastric juice contains these following molecules inside it, and it, by the help of pepsinogen, pepsinogen is the inactive form of pepsin, and its proteins digestion start in the stomach. Hydrochloric acid makes the acidic environment of gastric juice nearly pH 2, and parietal cells secrete hydrogen and chlorine ions, and this combined to form hydrochloric acid. And this hydrochloric acid makes the pepsinogen in the inactive form of pepsinogen to the active form of pepsin. This pepsinogen is secreted with the chef cells, and pepsinogen is activated to the pepsin with the help of hydrochloric acid. Mucus, there is a mucus secreting cell, they call goblet cells, located in the stomach also. And this mucus prevents the mucus protect the stomach lining from gastric juice. There are two opening of the stomach. They call sphincter. This is the esophageal sphincter and this pyloric sphincter. And this sphincter prevents chin from entering esophagus and regulate the entry and to the small intestine. Okay. This is the cross section of a mucosa layer in the stomach. There is a, we mentioned about the parietal and chef cells. The chef cells secrete the pepsinogen, and parietal cells secrete hydrochloric acid, and pepsinogen is activated with the hydrochloric acid. And after that, more pepsin is activated to pepsinogen, and it therefore the protein digestion, chemical digestion of protein can be started in the stomach. Okay. After the stomach, there is a small intestine. Small intestine, longest section of the alimentary canal or digestive canal. It is the major organ of digestion, both digestion and absorption. And also it secretes some enzymes. We call these enzyme brush border enzymes. And the small intestine have three parts. The first part is called duodenum, then jejunum and ileum. Most digestion is occurs in the duodenum, and mostly duodenum is where the pancreatic enzymes and bile from the liver is secreted to the duodenum. And also the peristaltic movement continues throughout the small intestine. And look at this picture. This yellow part is the duodenum, jejunum, and ileum. This is the last part of the small intestine. Small intestine lining have villus or microvilli in the epithelial cell. The villi or villus, singular, plural actually. Villi is the plural, villus is the singular. This is the folding of a lining of a small intestine, inner lining of a small intestine. This villus structure have both blood vessels, blood capillaries, and lacteals. Lacteals are the lymph capillaries. The lacteals and lymphatic system of lacteals and capillaries, blood vessels, blood capillaries of circulatory system is located inside these villi or villus. And this villi and microvilli formation, especially these microvilli in the epithelial cells, outer surface of epithelial cells, increases 600 times the increases the surface area of the small intestine. Therefore, most of the absorption occurs in the small intestine with the help of these huge surface area. Okay, small intestine linings start from inside. It starts from the mucosa. It is the composed of epithelial tissue, circular and longitudinal smooth muscle, connective tissue, and outside of these both stomach, small intestine, large intestine, and liver, also there is another membrane. It's called peritoneum. It covers the abdominal cavity. This is the last layer of abdominal cavity, peritoneum. Let's continue with the colon, large intestine. Colon is the 1.5 meter in length and 6.5 centimeter diameter. There is no villus formation in the large intestine because there is no digestion continues in the large intestine. Digestion is stopped at the small intestine. All the molecules is digested and all the monomers are now in the small intestine. Most of the monomers are absorbed on the small intestine, but some monomers can continue, for example, water and some vitamins and minerals is continue to absorb in the large intestine. Cecum is the part which connects the small intestine and large intestine. There is small structure called appendices, and this appendix is the region, small region between the connection of small and large intestine. And if there is an inflammation in this appendix, it's called appendicitis. This is the disease and very dangerous disease, appendicitis. And major function of the colon is absorption of water and minerals. Both waste of the digestive tract, the feces become more solid as they move through the colon, and the feces pass through the rectum and exit via the anus. Feces are stored in the rectum until they can be eliminated, and sphincter, there is also sphincter between rectum and anus, control the bowel movements. There is no digestion in the large intestine, but there is some kind of E. coli. This is the bacteria which synthesize vitamin B and K, and therefore vitamin B, K absorption, also water and mineral absorption occurs in the large intestine. Feces consisting of water, some inorganic salt, cells from the gastrointestinal tract and bacteria, bacterial decomposition and undigested food. Also, there is a ileocecal veil between the small intestine and large intestine. It prevents the food movement from large intestine to small intestine. Let's continue with the accessory organs. Liver, pancreas, salivary gland, and gallbladder are the accessory organs. Liver sends its excretion, the bile actually. Bile is the excretion of the liver. It can be stored in the gallbladder and it can be sent to the duodenum via common bile duct or colloduct. Pancreas have the pancreatic juice and it have some digestive enzyme and bicarbonate ions, and it is secreted to the duodenum via the this duct. This duct is called Wirsang duct or pancreatic duct, and both common bile duct and pancreatic duct opens to the ampulla of water in the duodenum. Bile is the secretion of liver, and bile responsible for the physical or mechanical digestion of fat or lipid. Gallbladder stores the lipid, not lipid, gallbladder stores the bile, but it is not synthesized. The bile is synthesized with the liver and stored in the gallbladder. Liver also have many other function except from the bile production. One of the function is the bile production. Also detoxification of drugs and alcohol, synthesize active vitamin A from provitamin A, maintains the glucose level, glucose concentration by converting glycogen to glucose or reverse, and convert amino acid to fat acid and glucose, the protein and carbohydrate and lipid metabolism, destruction of red blood cells, production of bilirubin in the bile, production of blood proteins such as albumin, fibrinogen, and heparin, convert ammonia to the urea, production of the erythropoietin hormone responsible for the more erythropoietin hormone responsible for to produce more red blood cells, and regulation of cholesterol and other fat, also production of red blood cell during the embryologic state. These are the other functions of liver besides bile production. Okay. Another accessory organ is the pancreas. Pancreas is both endocrine and exocrine gland. And as an endocrine gland, it secretes glucagon and insulin. They adjust the blood glucose level. And it's secreted, these glucagon and insulin secreted to the blood vessels. But pancreas also have exocrine function. As an exocrine function, pancreas secrete both sodium bicarbonate and digestive enzyme to the duodenum, to the small intestine, first part of the small intestine. These acidic chym can be neutralized with the help of this sodium bicarbonate, and there is another enzyme, pancreatic enzyme. These pancreatic amylase digest carbohydrate, trypsin, chymotrypsin, and peptidases. These enzymes digest proteins, lipase digest lipids, ribonuclease and deoxyribonuclease. These nucleases digest the nucleic acid. So all these digestive enzymes plus sodium bicarbonate is sent to the duodenum via Wirsing channel from the pancreas, and this is the exocrine function of the pancreas. The last accessory organ is the salivary gland. Salivary gland secretes saliva. Saliva have mucus, water, minerals, and amylase as an enzyme, digestive enzyme amylase. Also, there is a lysosome, antibacterial agent, lysosome and mucus present in the saliva. And this saliva lubricate this food. Tongue moves the food around until it forms a bolus. There are three pairs of these salivary glands, and both salivary glands, the amylase is important for the chemical digestion of starch and glycogen. Okay, let me continue with the hormones of digestive system. Digestive hormones are gastrin, secretin, cholecystokinin, and gastric inhibitor peptides. Mostly gastrin is secreted from the stomach, and it affects the stomach. It makes the stomach to release more gastric juice. Cholecystokinin is secreted from the small intestine, and it triggers the release of enzyme from pancreas. Also, it makes the cholecystokinin release of the, it stimulates the release of the enzyme from pancreas and release of the bile from gallbladder. But secretin is secreted from the small intestine. It goes again to organs. One of them is to pancreas. With the help of the secretin, pancreas the sends bicarbonate ions to neutralize the small intestine, and it also goes to the liver, and liver produce more bile with the help of this secretin hormone. Also, this secretin and cholecystokinin both have negative feedback effect on the motility of this stomach. Also, there is another inhibitory hormone. This is gastric inhibitory peptide. It also inhibits the gastric secretion and motility. But secretin, cholecystokinin, and gastrin both affect positive. They have positive effect on pancreas and liver and gallbladder. Okay. Let me continue with the chemical. Let me start the chemical digestion. In the second video, hopefully.